The
This
majorly the thing
conference will now be recorded.
the major thing is like, okay, what is the response time, right? So this is the most important things, like we used to present to the client, okay, for this transaction this is the response time. So most of us like used to present this much. Okay, then little more like, okay, so what are the other things like the throughput, hits per second, and some of the graphs like the virtual user graph, the throughput graph, or some transaction graphs. So some of the infrastructure usage graph like CPU usage graph, memory usage graph, or some network usage graph, or you can say the hard disk, some different things we used to present. So coming little above, so when we are talking about performance engineering, so our goal here is majorly to find the bottlenecks. Okay, so when we are doing the performance testing, how efficiently we can present the report with some additional things. Let's say we are reporting, okay, the CPU utilizations. How effectively we'll analyze the CPU utilizations. So what is the key things like if this is the case, whether it is a CPU bound or not. Okay, it's not like only 100%. If some CPU utilization is going beyond 85%, we'll simply present, no, we are seeing CPU utilization is going beyond 85%. That is not always correct. If CPU utilization is going 100% also, many times it is perfect. We don't have any issues with CPU utilization 100%. Okay, so let's say memory utilization. We normally say like, okay, if memory utilization is going more than 70%, so what we say like, okay, it is something like memory utilization is going more than 70%. So what is the issue? We don't have any issues. If memory utilization is going beyond 70%, still many cases we don't have any issues. No need to highlight it as a bug. Okay, sometimes the hard disk utilization, sometimes the network utilizations, because when coming to performance engineering things, these are the four key things like you have to analyze. One is CPU utilization, one is memory utilization, one is your hard disk, one is your network utilizations. Okay, so if you are able to analyze these things and its performance counters perfectly, okay, you can easily able to reach your bottleneck finding. Okay, let's say we are going for CPU utilizations. So we saw, okay, CPU utilization is something high. Now the question is, what makes this CPU utilization high? We know, okay, CPU utilization is 90%, but what is the thing in the application that is making the CPU utilization something high? That's we should find. Let's say we got to know, okay, my memory utilization is something high. Now the question is, what in the application making my memory utilization high? So how we will find that? Okay, let's say like my hard disk utilizations or my hard disk length. Okay, so that way like we have to find the exact cause. Let's say we come to know out of mind like hundreds of transaction, I come to know some of the clicks are showing high response time. Okay, so what is the bottleneck of that? So what caused that particular transaction to be at high end? What is the method, or what is the class, or what is the part of the code that is taking more time? Okay, so what we can do, like we can direct report to the dev team, like for this particular clicks I able to found this particular method or this particular class is taking, let's say, more CPU or more memory or more time to execute. If we can make it little less, then it will definitely decrease my response time. Okay, so that makes the work easy for the developer, directly go there and tune something and do it. Okay, Ananda, sorry to
yeah.
disturb you. Ananda, sorry
Yeah.
to disturb you. Are you sharing any screen, Ananda? Or do you have any slides?
No,
Just
no, 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 I am not sharing any screen.
wonderful. No
Okay.
issues. No issues. Go ahead.
Because, yeah, because guys try to understand whatever I am going to tell you, whatever I am going to, show you and explain you people, I will directly, go to the application and lively show you, okay, this is what happening and this is happening, then how you can find it. Okay, I don't have any PPT, like theoretically I will tell you so that you cannot understand anything. Theoretically, like you can also read from the internet or blogs, okay, this is the way, but to see live on the application, okay, this is the way I can monitor the CPU. This is the way I can find like which particular class or method is taking high CPU. Understood? So that way, like, it makes very, you know, easy to difficult, sorry, easy to remember the things, and so that, you know, you can also, you know, practice in your own laptop. Okay, take something like, I will tell you what are the things required to analyze or, you know, to find the bottleneck for these things. Okay, so then when I'm coming to other part, so the thread and heap, okay, these are the more you know, two of the very important things, okay, to find a bottleneck. So when we are talking about memory, we are talking about CPU, so we cannot, you know, do anything without thread and the heap, the memory utilization and the thread. How exactly threads are getting created, what is the status of the thread, what, like, you know, if there is any, you know, stock threads or block threads, what are the types of threads, okay, what is this thread concept, okay, behind any Java application. And one more thing, like, we are going to, you know, cover mostly on Java applications, okay, mostly on Java applications, okay. So how exactly you most of the people, like, you know, maybe heard about garbage collection, okay. So like, what is garbage collection, different algorithms, you know, what is the difference between different algorithms, if I will apply this algorithm what will happen, if I'll apply that algorithm what will happen, when we need different algorithms, okay. So whenever let's say like you are working on a particular application, so you can also recommend, okay, for this application we need this type of algorithms, okay. So that also we need to understand, okay. So because each and every algorithms work in a different way, okay. So like, we cannot simply, you know, take the most advanced Java garbage collection algorithm so that the application will, you know, perform better. It's not, because that also depends, like, depending upon your infrastructure, you have to choose a particular algorithm. It's not like blindly you can take any advanced things, okay. So like, let's say I'm coming to thread dump, heap dump, okay, how to take it, like in Windows box or, you know, in Linux box, because you people knows, like, most of the times our servers in an entire application where we have multiple web server, we have multiple application server, multiple database servers, most of the times the applications are hosted on Linux box, okay, Linux or Unix box. So how to, you know, deal there, like, how to take thread dumps, what is the best practice for it, how to analyze it, what, how to take, you know, a heap dump, what are the different, you know, procedure, different methods, like how I can take heap dump, you know, very efficiently, and how to analyze it, okay. So same thing, garbage collection, how to take or how to analyze a garbage collection, you know, logs. See, there are some third party tools, you can open the garbage collection, it will give you very beautiful results, okay. So that way you should not, you know, start your learning. First go to the logs, direct logs in any of the servers, okay, and see, try to read the logs and find out something from the garbage collection. If you are good in that, then this third party tools where, you know, graphical presentation is there, it will be very easy for you to understand, okay. So I will show you that how to take let's say like we are doing a test, so immediately I want to take some garbage collection graph, like, you know, logs. So how to take that, how to analyze, okay, in a notepad. We are not going to use any third party tool. Yeah, definitely, like somehow, like, I will show you some of the third party tools that will make your work little easy, but something like, we should start first, you know, analyzing the things, okay, from the logs, how to read the logs, how to get something from the logs, that also I will tell you. See, for thread dumps also there are some third party tools, okay. So where you can open the thread dumps, it will tell, okay, there is no, you know, no stock threads or no block threads, okay, but many times the tools also fails, okay. So better I will tell you how to open thread dump in a simple notepad, okay, and how to analyze it, okay. That way it makes sense, okay. So, and again, like, the as I said, we'll go for some database things, okay, how exactly database works, okay. So what is the best practices for a database, how to, you know, find something
let's say a database is having some CPU bound or memory bound or something like contentions, okay? Sometimes like these jargons, right? Contention, when I'm talking about contention, that is something like a deadlock, okay? Something like a deadlock. And deadlock can happen at any layer. It can happen in web logic, sorry, web server, application server, or database server, anywhere the deadlock can be possible. Okay, so how to analyze a AWR report? Okay, what is the best practice? What are the important points to touch? If I'm opening a AWR report, what is the important points, you know, I am going to touch? Okay, so that I can easily find something, like if AWR, you know, database is perfect, or database is, you know, finding some issues regarding CPU or memory, regarding any SQLs. Okay, so these are the things, like overall, like we are going to cover, you know, to easily find out any of the, you know, memory leak issues, sorry, any of the bottlenecks, comparing to the overall details like the CPU, memory. As I said, these are the hearts, CPU, memory, hard disk, and network. Okay, so what I can show you today, let's see. So most of us knows the CPU utilization, like there are many number of counters in the CPU utilization. Okay, so I want to share some of the situations. Okay, so let's say my CPU utilization is very less, something 60%. Okay, I cannot simply say my CPU is perfect. Why? Because let me share my screen. Just a minute. Hope you people are able to hear, see my screen, right?
Yes, Ananda, we are able to see it.
Yeah. When I'm coming to a CPU utilization, so you can see, like this is also one of the tools that we are planning to cover here. Some of the tools, like, you know, Java mission control. This is also one of the important tool to find or, you know, analyze your particular transaction. Let's say I'm submitting a form. Okay, what exactly happening when I'm submitting a form? Each and everything we can able to see. You can see the threads. We can see the memory. We can see many things like related to database. All these calls, how exactly happening? You can see the SQLs. Let's say I'm talking about a particular click. Okay, in my performance testing, let's say a particular click is taking more time. Okay, how to find when I'm doing that particular click, what is happening? Okay, so we can see, like, in this particular click, these are the SQLs getting executed. Okay, so when I'm coming to other things, so you can see these are the methods getting called. Okay, so we can see some of the important threads, some of the hot threads getting executed for that particular things. And when we are going to here, you can see there is a tree. Okay, so I will tell you people in that very detail, like how exactly we can find. If you go to this tree, we can easily find what is the method and what is the class, you know, contributing how much for that particular click. Okay, so then we can easily find out. Okay, so this is also one of the tool we are going to cover, that is Java mission control, or JFR. We normally say it's a JFR, Java flight recorder tool. And another tool like J profiler, you people might be heard about it, J profiler. That is also one of the licensed tool, but I will show you how exactly we can, you know, work on J profiler to find something important, like let's say, like I am doing a particular click. So what are the number of SQLs are getting executed for this particular clicks, and which SQL is taking how much CPU utilization, how much memory utilization, how much total time to find a particular bottleneck. So that level we can see. And I am doing a particular click,
So what are the number of classes, number of methods or functions getting executed for this particular click, and what is the breakdown? Let's say the particular click is taking 2 seconds, and how that 2 seconds is getting distributed among all these things. So how much time it is, you know, or taking in application level, how much time it is taking in database level. Okay, this level also we can, you know, find. If we find, then easily we can find the bottleneck. Okay, the bottleneck is not from the database, it is from the, let's say, application server. And if it is from application server, so which is the method or which is the class? So that's all, that should be our goal, right? So again, like, let me, I was telling you the CPU, right? Okay, so when I'm talking about something like simple CPU utilization, let's say something it is more than 85%. As like, no, we as performance tester, we used to report it. Now I am seeing CPU utilization is more than 85%. Okay, but after then, if CPU utilization is more than 85%, whether it is a problem or it is not a problem at all, that we have to explain to the customer or to the client. Okay, if somebody is telling, no, I am able to see like CPU utilization is 85%, then we should reply to that person whether it is actually good or no need to worry. Okay, or it is actually bad. Okay, how we come to know? There are many counters in the performance, you know, all this monitoring. Let's say we are monitoring the CPU, we have to monitor many performance counter. As you all knows, like, we have set up performance counters. So these counters are the numbers. Okay, these counters are the numbers from where we can come to a conclusion if CPU is working perfectly or the system is a CPU bound. Okay, I'm just increasing the fonts. Okay, let's come to CPU. Okay, when I'm talking to CPU, so we have a counters like percentage of, what is that, processor utilization. Okay, so normally this one is the total. There are two counters here, total. What is the total CPU processing power? When I am doing a performance testing, what is the total CPU utilization happening? Because we have different CPUs, right? We have quad core, we have octa core, we have dual core processor. Okay, how exactly it is happening? Let's say we have a dual core, two core machine. We know my server is a two core. It is a two core CPU. Okay, so now I can see I have one is processor total, one is instance level. When I'm talking about two core, I have two instances of my CPU. Okay, so that means if this one is telling you 85% or something 90%, okay, you can say like, okay, my CPU utilization I am seeing near to 90%. Okay, then next we have to see this instance. So it will be coming under instance one. Let's say it is instance one and the separate one is instance two. So here it can show you something. Let's say it is showing something 100%. Okay, it can be something, you know, it is showing something 100%. Okay, so this one can show you 90%, or it can show you here 100% also. So how you can come to a conclusion here? Okay, so you have to see each and every core is also working perfectly or not.
Okay, so it can, let's say it is a four core, let's say it is a four core. Okay, it can be. Hello?
Yeah, we are able to hear you.
Yes, some network fluctuation may be. So, okay, let's say it is four core. So you may see this one something, you know, something 150. Okay, something 130. Okay, so this way it can be. Okay, something you can see this. Something, let's say 200. So now, so you will be afraid, like, okay, why this becomes something 200%? I am saying this instances utilization is something 200%. Okay, you should find a conclusion here. Okay, so normally what happened on a OS perspective, we say the instance level, okay, instance level should be greater than equal to, if it is greater than equal to 50 into number of cores, okay, then only we can be little bit bother. Okay, we will be thinking like, okay, it can cause a problem. Okay, so this way, so when it is coming to 90%, we cannot say, okay, this is a problem or not. But when we are coming to this one instance level, the core level, okay, we can identify which core is causing the problem. We have four instances. If you are going for a four core CPU, we have four instances of the CPU. So here it is four. So if it is going up to 200 or 200 plus, okay, we can say it can be a problem. At the same time, let's say we have something else. We have something privilege time. Okay, we have something CPU queue length. Okay, so this privilege time, it is something like, you can say 70 to 80%. What is this privilege time? Okay, normally this is the time given by the CPU for any IO operations, okay, any memory allocation. Let's say my application requires some more memory during the execution, it all of a sudden requires some more memory. Okay, so who will do the work? It is definitely the CPU who is going to do the work. If my application requires some input output operations, okay, if my application requires some network operations, okay, or some file operations, okay, so definitely it is the CPU that is giving time. Okay, so just imagine my processor is giving less time for my application to run the code and all. Okay, at the same time it is giving more time for IO, memory allocation, this and that. Okay, if that is the case, let's say here it is 100%. I am seeing CPU utilization is 100%. Total CPU utilization. And the same time, I am seeing this one, my privileged time is something less than 70% to 80%, or my queue length. My queue length, CPU queue length, it is something here less than 8. Okay, so I can say my CPU is perfect. There is no issue at all at my CPU. My CPU is working perfectly. Though it is showing 100%, still I will say my CPU is working perfectly. Okay, So just imagine this core, this queue length, it is just something beyond 10 or 12 for a long time. Okay, and how to monitor this? How to monitor this queue length? That also I am going to explain. Okay, so this is just a scenario wise I am just giving you in a demo class. Okay, so just imagine it is more than 10, 12 for a long time. I am talking on the example of 4-core CPU. I am taking this example. If my CPU is a 4-core machine, okay, when it is greater than 10 to 12 for a long time, I am seeing it, and my CPU utilization is something beyond 90%. Here I can say I am having a CPU problem. Okay, my CPU is not sufficient to do the work. So hope you understand the two differences. When my CPU is 100%, I can say, well, while seeing this, while analyzing these two figures, I can say my CPU is not having any issues, it is perfect. But when I'm seeing this one is something greater than 10, 12, I can say, and this one is 90%, still I'm saying my CPU is having a problem. Okay, so this way we have to analyze and we have to tell whether my CPU is perfect or not. Okay, there are many other counters. Okay, so we have interrupts per second, we have percentage of interrupt time, right? There are many counters that we can analyze to tell whether my CPU is working perfectly and something perfect for my application or not. Let's say interrupts per second. Okay, so what is this interrupts per second? We have many hardwares in our servers. Okay, so when any interrupts can happen, like let's say I'm sending a request to my hardware is not responding for some millisecond. Okay, that is the interrupts. My CPU have to handle it. Okay, so anything goes wrong while interacting to a third party, while interacting to a hardware, let's say my hard disk, my network interface or my network adapter, okay, my RAM. So many things are there inside your server, right? Sorry, inside your application servers, okay, inside your machines. So anywhere any problem happen, so that calls a interrupts. So here I'm not talking about software interrupts. Okay, I'm talking about hardware interrupts. Okay, so how many interrupts per second it should handle the CPU? Just imagine, like, if my CPU is busy, fully busy to handle the interrupts, then when he will give some time for my application? So if my interrupts per second is something very high, okay, normally a 64-bit processor, so 64-bit processor, we normally target near to 5,000 to 10,000. Sometimes up to 10,000, we don't have any issues. Okay, for a Unix box, okay, kernel 4, and or a Windows box of, you know, Windows 10 and all, with 64-bit machines. Okay, this is just a target. When it is going beyond this, we can say like some of the hardwares is, you know, not performing well. Okay, because CPU is fully busy of handling this. So when we are monitoring this, same time we have to see how much time exactly CPU is giving to handle the interrupts. Okay, sometimes if it is just more than 30%, still we can say CPU is giving more time for the interrupts. Okay, so here main thing is we have to correlate each and everything. We have to first see this, then directly come to, if it is something more, try to see which of the instance actually causing the problem. Just a minute. Battery is draining. Okay. Okay. So here
Let's say one more situation I'm explaining you. So I'm saying my CPU utilization is something near to 50%. It is just 50%. Okay, but still I see high response time for my transaction. So this also we have to analyze, right? Like I am seeing my CPU is something just 50% utilization, and my memory utilization, let's say I am putting one more example, one more scenario, like here I am seeing my memory is something just 60% utilized. Okay, something hard disk is perfect. Hard disk is perfect. My network bandwidth is perfect. Now I see high response time for my transactions. Some of the transactions is going very high. Okay, so what can be the cause here? How to find? I'm saying this, see this level everything is perfect, right? So still I'm seeing something high response time for my transaction. So now definitely my delivery manager, my customer, definitely they will ask, so when everything is perfect, so why I am seeing a response time something high? Now what we have to see here, see when I'm talking about memory is just 60% used, that means my RAM is perfect. Okay, same time I have to see the heap uses, I have to see the thread stats. Okay, so here this one is the important. Okay, so sometimes what happen due to some deadlock situation, due to some thread contentions, okay, what happen, let's say for this particular transaction, see whenever I am doing some actions, that actions are actually performed by threads. Okay, so each and every actions that you do indirectly, a thread is responsible to do that action. Okay, so just imagine I'm trying to do a particular action, and the threads responsible to do that actions are something waiting, something, you know, stuck, something, you know, contention happened, something, you know, blocked. You can say it can be blocked, it can be stopped, okay, or it can go to a deadlock. Okay, see here these things are perfect, but still due to this type of situation I see this my response time can be something very high, something 5 minutes or 10 minutes. Okay, so we have to here analyze the complete thread statistics. Okay, we have to completely analyze the heap or thread stats. Okay, there are some different tools available in the market. We'll see like what are the tools, or without a tool how we can analyze, okay, how to find whether it is a block or whether it is a stuck thread, okay, whether like any deadlock type situation is happening. Okay, so this is the best way to analyze and figure out what can be the cause. Okay, so easily. So then coming to heap uses, so though my memory to total memory uses, let's say I have a 4 GB RAM, so I can see around some 2 GB or 2.5 GB is used, but still I have enough memory, right? Still I have left with 1.5 GB, but still I have to see the heap uses, because we have a min heap size and then a max heap size. Okay, just imagine though my memory utilization is some 60%, but my heap utilization is something 100%. Okay, so if my heap utilization is something 100%, definitely now my transactions will start responding slowly. Okay, when I am utilizing near to 100%, my transactions should, you know, go slow now. Okay, because I don't have enough memory to execute my applications. When I'm starting my Java applications, so everything is running between this min and max heap, everything running inside the heap. Okay, everything happening inside the heap. Okay, so how, what is the heap structure? what is the architect of this heap, how exactly the codes run inside the heap, that also we'll see. Okay, so we have different you know areas. Let's say you people might have you know knows all these things, but we'll discuss in a depth. So we have young space, okay, we have old space, we have something like meta, or we can say porn space. Okay, we'll see like how exactly young works, how exactly old work, what is the definition, what is the use of this. Okay, when like you know we'll analyze old, when we'll analyze meta, form, okay, all these things. So here just imagine I come to know my heap is having some issue. Definitely if this is the case, it can, if some issue is happening here, it can affect my response time, that also I can present. So here I want to say, as a performance tester, when I'm seeing some high transactions, high response time for a particular transactions, so instead of reporting, okay, this transaction is showing something high time, we will add all this our analysis. We'll add all our analysis. We can say we are able to see some of the threads are, you know, going to block state. What are the threads? That thread details we can report. At the same time, let's say we are analyzing the heap, we can say we are able to see there is some issues, okay, from the garbage collection or from the heap side that cause this particular transaction high response time. So that makes sense. Okay, so now the dev have to be find it out. Okay, we are not going to, you know, directly go to the code and change and do this. Okay, that level, like as a you should be a perfect developer in that case. Okay, you should be a perfect Java developer, or you know any of the coding developer and all. Okay, so this way the work is easier now for the dev team to find if there is any issues. Okay, just imagine this side, and when we can go for database also. Okay, just imagine here while analyzing the thread, I come to know this thread is waiting for a long time for the database reply. Okay, if that is the case, so I have to see in the database what exactly happening here. If I come to know something is wrong happening here, and this thread which is actually responsible for this transaction, so I can easily, you know, correlate the things. So database, this is the problem. Due to this problem, this thread is waiting, and as this thread is waiting, my transaction is having high response time. That is a clear, you know, report to present. Like this is how I am getting a high response time. Okay, so here in the from the thread starts, we can easily come to know whether we are, you know, trying to get a connection, or you know, trying to get a reply from the database, or trying to get a connection, or you know, reply from any third party applications, because our application can communicate n number of, you know, different applications also. Like nowadays, let's say like we have some different web server or image server, so they are like, when thread is trying to get something from the image server, or you know, thread is trying to get something from the you know, let's say a printer, from the printer side, that also we can find here from the thread start. Okay, so accordingly we have to monitor. Okay, that also I am going to show you. It all comes under the complete thread starts analysis. Okay, so from database, if it is from database, so again immediately we have to take the AWR and see what is happening inside the database. So how to take AWR reports, okay, how to, you know, fetch it from different format, like you can open the AWR report in HTML, all these things. So I have, I think, opened some of the AWR report. Yeah, you can see one sample AWR report I have taken in some of my latest project. So these are the things, like many different sections are available. You can see host details, the DB details, report summary, okay, many things are, foreground events by total wait time, okay, so something like wait classes by total wait time, host CPU, instance CPU, IO profiles, memory statistics.
So many things are there here. We will see what are the important sections here, how we can come to know like my database is working perfectly or not, is there any issues, okay? So that level also we'll see, okay? So now you got an overall idea actually, like what are the things we are going to cover, right? So mainly we can see all possible counters first, how to analyze each and every counters.
Ananta, sorry to disturb. So the course content that you have shared with me, right? Can you display it here and then quickly go through them? So that, you know, it will be more like a summary as well as they know clearly what will be covered.
Yeah, correct. I think that I shared you with in my WhatsApp.
right. So if you want, I've put it in a document. Should I send it to you?
Just a minute. I'll open here. No problem.
So should I send it to you?
No, here I can open it.
Okay, sure.
Just now open.
So I have emailed you, Ananta. So in case, you know, if you have, okay, you have this one here. Okay, yeah.
Yeah, I just copied it from WhatsApp.
So just if you copy it into a Word document, you know, it's nicely being covered. I mean, it's getting what do you say, aligned properly.
Okay, then. Okay.
Can you copy the same thing into a Word so that automatically it's aligned?
Correct.
Maybe you can bold it so that it becomes clear, and then yeah. You have to say Control A and then yeah.
Okay. Okay, so now like hope you can see that. So these are the things like tools to be used in performance engineering. Okay, so we'll see different tools, performance counters. So this part, as I said, you have to, you know, go and remember a lot of theoretical OS level things, like, you know, when we are going for CPU counters, memory counters, hard disk counters, network counters. Okay, these are completely, you know, operating system labels, as we have, you know, studied in our B or BTech or you know, graduation. So that we have to remember. Once we remember the things, then now as I explained some of the situations, right, we can correlate each and everything and how to come to a conclusion. Okay, whether I have something CPU problem, or I have something memory problem, or I have something hard disk, or I have something network problem. Okay, so when I'm coming to JBMs, as I said, we'll see the JBMs, JBM architect. Okay, then garbage collection, different algorithms. Okay, when and how, like we have different algorithms in garbage collections. We have parallel garbage collections, we have parallel old garbage collections, we have CMS garbage collection, we have G1 garbage collections. This one is the latest one, G1 garbage collections. Okay, so we'll see like what is the difference and what is the benefit of using any things. Like we cannot, you know, randomly pick any garbage collection algorithm and use in our applications. So in market there are different types of applications. We have corporate applications, we have retail applications, banking applications. Some people, you know, demands
I want a perfect response time. Okay, so what are the possible algorithm we can use that type of application? Some people demands like whatever may be my response time, I want a high throughput. Okay, so the work done, something, you know, very high-fi, like let's say batch job type of applications. Let's say it is a banking application. What it does, night time, it process a lot of batch files. Okay, so that time we should be bothered about the throughput, okay, not the response time. Okay, so like in that type of application, which algorithm is something best? Okay, and depending, let's say I have a very big server, I have a very big application server where I have a RAM of, you know, 32 GB and I have a hard disk of, you know, 1 terabyte, or CPU is having something 16 core CPU. Okay, so this type of machines, so what type of algorithm we will use if my application is running in such a huge machine? So what can be the, you know, best practice? Okay, whether we can go for this type of algorithm or we can use that type of algorithm. Okay, that also you can recommend to the dev team. Okay, like as my you know, RAM size is something huge or heap size is something huge, so what can be the possible, you know, implementations? So that way also we'll see different algorithms, differences. So when to use what type of algorithms? Okay, so mainly these two algorithms, okay, CMS and G1GC. We'll lively see what is CMS and how exactly it's happening line by line. We'll see. Okay, and G1GC also I'll tell you. See, like question wise, many people will ask you, okay, what is parallel garbage collection? When I will use parallel garbage collection, when I will use CMS. Okay, explain me how exactly CMS is happening, what are the different steps, what is the benefit of it. Okay, but you can read it from internet, but when you are seeing it, okay, from the server, let's say I'm you know, logging into my running server and I'm showing you there, okay, this is the CMS algorithm, and see how exactly it is happening. Okay, that way it makes sense and you will feel comfortable and easy to remember. Okay, heap dump, and why we need this, as I shared, like the complete heap analysis we'll do, and when it is required to take a heap dump, what is the possible way, what is the possible method to take, like from the tool side, from the command side. Okay, what are the different commands in Linux to take a heap dump and all. Okay, same types like thread dump. Okay, what is the need of taking a thread dump, when to take, and how to analyze. It's not like simply you will take a thread dump. Okay, so like how to take and what is the best way to take, that also we have to see. What are the tools we are using to analyze this thread dump? Okay, then coming to AWR. Okay, you can see analysis, how to take AWR. See, you can see JFR, this is a tool. JFR is the tool, JProfiler is a tool. Okay, so this tool is mainly used for, you know, database, JDBC details, you know, then CPU analysis details. Okay, just I opened here, right? So I can see here which of the method is taking how much CPU and all. Okay, you can see here, right? This is the CPU utilization of that particular thread. Okay, if I'm going down, so slowly you can see a breakdown there. Okay, you can see this. It is the Eclipse which is actually executing that particular code, and you can see the 20%. So out of this total 69% uses, so this particular thing is taking 20%. So how to find the detail, you know, object label or class labels. Okay, and one more things, like I have not put here, I think the memory analysis. Okay, so how to find which is actually causing the memory leak inside the, you know, heap, inside the heap, which is actually causing the memory leak problem. So you people, you know, most of us knows what is memory leak. Okay, definition wise we knows the things, graph wise also we can explain, but I will show you exactly how the memory leak is happening. Okay, and how we can easily find out which particular code, which particular part in the application is actually responsible for the memory leak, and how to, you know, come to that conclusion. Okay, this is the things that is actually causing my memory leak. Okay, so that level also I will explain you. Yeah, these are the overall things we are going to cover in this particular sessions. So anyone having anything extra, like anything extra you want to know, can you please tell me, like, yeah, I want to know these things or that things.
Yeah, Ananta, this is Rajesh here. So
what you can
give us any of the application performance, APM tool, like Dynatrace, why?
Okay.
Another tool. Yeah, the APM tool system.
Okay, so you want to know, like, whether we are going to cover any APM tools, right? Right? Any APM tools?
Yeah, correct.
Yeah, so these things, right? If I'm going to cover APM tools, this itself will take a lot of times. If you can see, I have the Dynatrace here. Okay. So I have the lively the Dynatrace available here, so I can explain. Okay, so but the thing is, like, we should have a particular bandwidth to explain it. I will speak to Kumar, and Kumar can speak to you. Okay,
so
that will make sense.
Ananta, let me quickly jump in here. So please correct me if I'm wrong here. So Rajesh, we will be using the free open source tools. As you can see here, we can use the JProfiler, which is an open source, and JMC, which is an open source tool as well. So they are the APM tools. Ananta, I hope I am talking right? So they are the APM tools as well, but they comes with the Java, and they are available for free. So once you learn how to look at the stuff from these free tools, so the paid tools like Dynatrace, you'll be able to see the same stuff. For example, we are talking about the thread dump. Okay, so thread dump, we are going into the JProfiler or JMC and seeing it. So once you understand how to do the analysis for the thread dump, whether you're using the Dynatrace or whether you're using the AppDynamics or whether you're using the JProfiler, the process is the same. Okay, just that where you go and look for the stuff changes. Same thing with the heap dump. So, what we are showing you is, if you don't have any tool, how to get it, like, when you don't have any tool. So, which means that the tougher path we are showing you, and the easier path is however easy, like once you have Dynatrace, so it becomes easy to go get the heap dump and then analyze from there. So, we're going to show you how to analyze, we're going to show you how to get it if you don't have any tool. So, if you have any tools, the process becomes that much easier. Okay, so the expectation here is to teach you the performance engineering as to how to do the thread dump analysis, heap dump analysis, or figure out the bottlenecks if you don't have any tools, using the open source tools.
Yeah.
So keeping this knowledge, the expectation is you take this knowledge to the profiling, outside profiling tools.
Yeah.
So this is our expectation.
So rather, so what said, that is absolutely right, because let's say I open my Dynatrace. Okay, so in Dynatrace you can lively monitor the things, as it is APM, application performance management tool. So here you can take a heap dump easily, you can monitor the heap. Okay, you can take a heap dump and analyze it. Here you can monitor the thread, and you can take a thread dump and analyze it. You can see the business transaction level and which level layer it is actually causing the problems. So that is what, like, how to take a heap dump, how to analyze it. Okay, that definitely we are going to cover, and how to find a bottlenecks, let's say the thread dump and all. So if you know all these things, let's say I'm going to Dynatrace now, so it will be easy, right? Like, instead of going into the application, directly take it here, I can take a thread dump, I can start my analysis. Okay, so that way it will help the APM tools, all the license tools. Okay, so that's why, like, we are covering the JFR. That is the most commonly used software, that JFR and J J J profiler, this one is actually a license store. J profiler is actually a license store. Okay, but this I am going to cover as this is a license, but I have the license I am going to cover, and the JFR, okay, this is open source. It comes with the JDK. Okay, but J profiler. Yeah, tell me please.
Yeah, hi Nand, this is Chandan. So Chandan, I just wanted to know, like, so what are the tools you are going to cover? Is it only JFR and J profiler, or are you going to cover any other tool? And one more thing is, like, you mentioned, like, you will show how to do it without tool as well, right?
Yeah, without tool, how to do it.
Yeah, so and basically, how, what are the tools you are going to cover?
So normally, these are the two tools we are going to cover, and one is the IBM MAT.
Okay.
Okay, IBM MAT. Then one more tool is anyway, like AWR, like I'm not going to tell the details of OEM, like, you know, OEM, this is Oracle Enterprise Management, that I'm not going to tell, but how to take the AWR and how to analyze the AWR, that I'm going to cover. Okay, majorly these three. Okay, because thread dump any of the counters, okay, that we don't want a tool for thread. See, for thread analysis we have online tools, okay, online free tools, but we are not going to use that tools. Definitely I will tell you, okay, these are the tools, you know, you can, you know, open your thread log and thread starts and see what are the things, but analyzing, you know, let's say I'm running my applications. Instantly, I want to see what is happening in my threads. Okay, what are the thread starts and all that I cannot do by using any tool. Okay, my application is running, it is inactive. Okay, my performance test is running, it is in ongoing phase. Instantly, I want to see something in my thread. Okay, how to do that? I don't want any tool there, right? So I have to log into that particular server and how to take a thread dump instantly and see if there is some issues from the thread level, right? So that way we have to, you know, analyze the things, because see, the complete run happened and you taken some thread dump in between, and later on if you are analyzing, either you can analyze by using any tools or manually you can analyze, but on the spot actively how you will do, definitely you are not going to use any tools. Okay, immediately take a thread dump and see what exactly happening there, right? The same thing for AWR, we don't want any tool. We can save it in a HTML and open it and analyze, start analyzing and see whether we have any issues, right?
Okay, thank you. So I have two more questions. Sorry, I'm taking a little more time.
No problem. Yeah, tell me.
Okay, the second thing is, like, in many of the organizations we do not have direct access to servers.
Yeah, correct.
In that case, like, how we can do all this, like, heap dump and thread dump?
Correct. See, if in I know, like, many of the organizations or many of the clients don't give access for any web server, application server, database server. There, if you want to actually do the things, see, they must have some way to take it, right? Let's say they have implemented APM. Okay, they have the Dynatrace. Okay.
No, let's say we do not have any APM tools, then how can
exactly. we? Exactly. Yeah, exactly. If they don't have any things to connect, you cannot take even. Okay. So maximum what you can tell, like, from their infrastructure team, you can request, okay, take one thread dump, or, you know, take one memory dump and give me so that I can analyze. That is the one choice left. Okay.
Is there any way we can do it remotely?
You can do remotely, okay, but if you are doing remotely anyway, like, you are like, finally you are, you know, you must connect it to their infrastructure. Without connecting to their web server or application server or database server, you cannot take any profilings, you cannot take any report or logs, right? So you must be connected. If they are not giving access, you cannot do anything, you are helpless. So either you have to connect to, either you have to connect to the infrastructure team and or their side, like the team who is, you know, managing all these servers, to ask them, request them, okay, give me a logs or run this command and give me this file. That they can do. If there is an APM tool, let's say they have a APM tool, they don't want to give you the access. They simply give you a URL and a login. You can just open the URL and login. Let's say it is a Dynatrace. So I can configure it my side. As a client, I configured it. So finally, I am giving you the just the login URL and credentials. Okay. So you can open it. Now it is up to you, like what you want. You can take thread dump, heap dump, anything you can take and do the analysis.
And my next question is, like, you know, the whatever the heap dump, thread dump, and AWR reports you are going to show. Okay. So is it going to be on the live applications or some kind of dummy applications? So how you are going to show us?
Yeah. Thing is, I don't have any dummy applications. Okay. I don't have any dummy applications. So I will show you in the live applications only. Let's say I am running some test. Okay. So I can just, you know, go there and, you know, take some AWR and show you what is happening there. Okay. My application is running. I have a entire applications. I have a completely entire applications. It is having four web servers. It is having a four application server, one database server. It is having two load balancers. Okay. In that architect, I will show you. Okay. Like, let's say I want to take something from the application servers. Okay. I want to see something from the application server logs. Okay. I will take you through the meeting or through our sessions. Okay, I'm logging to this machine. Let's take some thread dump and see what exactly happening. Okay, that way I will explain.
So how we are going to practice it, or how we are going to, you know, like explore?
Yeah. See. Yeah. Here, being honest, I will tell you one thing. This concept, right? How to find it? How to analyze the, you know, thread dump? You know, heap dump? Or how to analyze the memory dumps in IBM MAT or JProfiler or JFAR, okay? There is no such rule, there is no such formula like, okay, open the thread dump and, you know, click here, click there, and this is the solution. No, there is nothing like this, okay? This concept is purely the way, you know, you are thinking, the way you are correlating the things, you are able to correlate many things, then only you can come to a conclusion. And the number of days, okay, you will try to read the thread dumps, you will try to read the heap dumps, then only you can come to a conclusion and a comfort zone. Okay, now I can able to find something, I can able to analyze something. Okay, so let's say, like, you know, constantly you try to read. If you are not able to understand the thread dump, try to go through it, okay, 100 times. Then only you can come to a conclusion, okay, this is the that, this is the concept, okay. Now I can see what is my duty is, I will tell you how exactly you can start, how exactly you can come to a conclusion. But don't take my lines as a formula. Okay? That's what I want to say. Don't take my lines as a formula. So I can say,
you are going to share all the best practices. That we can provide.
Exactly. See, let's say I have a thread dump. I will say you how exactly we can read a thread dump, how exactly we can come to a conclusion. Okay, so once you know how to read it, I will request you take multiple thread dumps. Okay, if in your application something is there, let's say you are running a JMeter. Okay, JMeter is nothing but a Java application, right? So you can take a thread dump of your JMeter and try to see, okay, what are the things coming in my thread dump? Okay, so like how the threads are related, how the threads are accessing one object, you know, getting executed, understood? Okay, what is the thread principle? Then only you can slowly come to a conclusion. Okay, this is the way to analyze a thread dump. Okay, so let's say I am going for a heap dump. Okay, I will show you what is the way to analyze it. How you can start, what is the starting point, okay? How to, you know, reach to a particular point. This is the way I will show you. But let's say I am showing some particular class, okay? This is the topmost class and, you know, causing the problem. And in your heap dump, people try to search that class, you will not get it, right? So the way like it's a different. It's not a formula level. Understood?
Okay, thank you. Thank you so much.
Yeah, Anand,
the concept I'll understood. Let's say like I'm going to AWR. Okay. So AWR, there are some formulas, okay, that we can remember and apply in our AWR. Okay. And there are something like some points. You can directly go to that point and see. So each and every points having some theoretical concept. Okay, so if this theory is applying here, then I can say, okay, this is perfect. Okay, so let's say like I'm opening an AWR. Where it is that? Okay, this one. Let's say I'm seeing here something library hit. Okay, so why exactly it is 99.98%? Whether it is good or bad. Let's say it is none per CPU. It is 98%, whether it is good or bad. What is this none per CPU? So that level I will explain you. Then you can easily, if you able to remember, whenever you are opening a AWR, you go to here and try to see what is my none per CPU. If it is something this much percentage, you can come to a conclusion. Okay, this is perfect. Understood? Let's say I'm seeing what is soft parse. Let's say I'm seeing, okay, this is this much percentage. So I can easily come to know, okay, this much percentage, okay, whether it is good or bad. Okay, I will explain this. Then only you can easily, you know, correlate and, you know, find out or come to a conclusion whether it is perfect or not, right? So that I will explain.
Hello, Ananda.
Thank you.
Hello.
Yeah, tell me.
Yeah, Ananda. Yeah, hi, Afaq. Am I audible?
Yeah, audible. Tell me.
Yeah, Ananda, as you mentioned, like we're going to cover JFR, open source, and JProfiler license tool, and IBM MI tool in our future session to cover this thread dump and heap dump. Is there any chance we can also cover JVisual VM inbuilt tool, which is come under the JVM?
Yeah, like we'll see, definitely. Yeah, I forgot. JVisual VM, we'll see. Okay, and even.
Also in our session?
Yeah, we'll see JVisual VM. We can see this, no problem. Because this is also like a open source, but it can gives us, you know, a good analysis.
Okay.
This also we'll see. Yeah.
Just want to. Okay, thank you.
And one more tool is there also, JProfile, right? Something JMap or JProfile is also there.
Yeah, JProfile also. I think it's inbuilt tool. Yeah, it comes under JVM.
Yeah, it comes on you know, by default in JDK.
Yes, okay. JDK. Yes.
So we'll see all these tools. I'll show you at a part exactly and how we can monitor through this JProfiler or JVisual VM. What we can do. Okay.
Thank you.
Just a quick moment. So guys, who doesn't have any questions, please self-mute yourself because it's kind of having some background noise. I do appreciate if you have questions. But once you are done with the questions, mute yourself. And once, I'm so happy if you are able to speak. Just that, you know, once you are done, mute yourself. That's the only request I have because it's creating some background noise because of which, you know, we are not able to hear the questions as well as the responses. So thanks, Avish. So Mohammed, you can carry on. Please ask your questions. And then Avish might have the questions he can ask. And same with Chandan as well. Okay, but one at a time, please. Thank you for understanding. I'm going on mute.
Yeah, any questions, like anybody want to you know, add something here?
Are you going to explain the JVM arguments as well in detail?
Yeah, so like the important arguments. So when I'm talking about, you know, JVM, the heap size, how you can, you know, handle the situation. So definitely I am going to cover a lot of JVM arguments. Okay. So what is the use of these arguments? When we can use it, that I will tell you. Okay. I will make some situations. Okay. Let's say like I am using this argument. What can happen? If I am not using this argument, what will happen? If let's say I am adding this much value, what will happen? That way. Okay, let's say like I come to know I have some high response time happening. If I will use this argument in this way, how exactly it is going to affect my response time? Okay, whether it is going to decrease it or it is going to increase it, okay? And how I can use different arguments, JVM arguments, so that, you know, it can affect, you know, it can lower down my response times, okay? That way, like, there are many arguments I will tell you. Because that is also important to remember, because if you are going for any interview level, people normally ask, okay, what are the important arguments you know, what is the need of these, whether you actually use this argument or not, when you applied this, this type of things, right? So we'll cover that, no problem.
Hello, Ananta, Mohammed.
Yeah, Mohammed. Tell me.
As you mentioned, like, you're going to show us all this heap dump and thread dump by using the open source and license tool on the live application. So can you also, or like, do you have any plan to cover the mobile application also for this thing?
No, Mohammed, we are not. Yeah, I understand. We are not covering any mobile applications here.
Okay. Only for the web applications, right? Am I correct?
Yeah, web applications.
Okay, Ananta. Okay, fine. Thank you.
Okay. So I think he may be looking for mobile level, you know, counters or how to do profiling and all for mobile applications.
Yeah, understood. But we are not covering that.
Okay. It would be better if you can just was at least one application or something.
Ananta. I actually don't have that setup, honestly. Okay.
Oh, okay. Thank you.
We do actually, like, on our office project and all, we do a lot of, you know, mobile level benchmarking and all. But here, actually, I don't have that authorization to use it, you know, unauthorized. It can cause a problem.
Okay.
This is Rajesh here. Okay.
Yeah, Rajesh. So,
to cover the web server performance counter and client side metrics.
Sorry?
Are you going to cover the web server performance counter, like you mentioned, application server, DB server? So, we're going to cover it.
So, there are some, like, as we know, like these counters, right? These hardware counters, like, are common in all the things. But, same time, like I'll tell you, like, there are some counters in application server and web servers. So that level, let's say we are trying to, you know, increase some of the session counts, or trying to increase the connection poolings, okay, try to increase the number of threads that a particular server can handle. That level I'll show you, like, where to go and how to increase this. Okay, let's say, like, a particular machine is having, you know, maximum 100 threads. So we cannot run there. Let's say we are planning to do a test of, you know, some 1,000 users. Okay, so that time, like, if our number of sessions and threads levels are less, so we cannot run 1,000 users, right? So I will tell you, like, where exactly go and how to change it, right? I'll tell you that. Right?
Now, what are the client side metrics, so, like, how to correlate the client side with the application and how about the client side metrics? So, like, hits per second, throughput. So, while you're going to cover that one, is how to correlate with that client side metrics with that application numbers, how to outcome with the response time.
Yeah, like normally, normally, like, let's say client side metrics, we are seeing, okay, something like the throughput and the hits per second, okay, it should be parallel, right? As we know, as a performance tester, we know, like, if application is working perfectly, so both hits per second and throughput should be parallel, right? Hits per second is increasing and throughput is coming down, that is ASO. So when hits per second is increasing, definitely throughput also should increase, right? So that graph level things and all, yeah, we can just see it, like, we can just, you know, correlate and we can go to depth, right?
Hi, Ananta, Dr. Ravish.
Yeah, Ravish, yeah, tell me.
Avis. Actually, like we say that can we are using also Unix system to see that all these things.
Yeah, actually most of the things like I'm going to cover in Unix only because I have the complete setup in Unix. My application is running. So here also like we'll try to cover some important commands from the Unix side. Useful when we are doing the test in a Unix environment because most of the applications runs on Unix. So some of the important commands like we have to remember when we are working on server side, right? So that things I'll definitely cover.
And since I have joined very late because some problem in my side, so initial stage like initial of this demo, you mentioned that out of memory error some kind of given, right?
Yes.
Okay, fine. Thank you.
So guys, thanks for joining. Chandan, I'll pass on to you. Just give me a moment. So as I've told you at the starting of the class, at this point of time, only 5 students per batch, and the batch will start shortly. So most likely it will be from day after tomorrow. So I'll talk to Ananta personally on that, and I will let you know the exact start date. So we have, as I've told you, I'm taking only 5 students per batch. So somebody is interested, please go ahead and register. The first come, first serve basis is only what I'm looking at. Okay, no. So that's about it. And Ananta, weekly how many classes is something that we can take? And can we confirm on the dates or will it be on the fly? So let's do it offline or let's talk it over here of this students. Ananta?
Yes, like that we can plan accordingly, like what is the time and how many days we'll we'll be in 1 week. So that details we'll discuss and confirm to each one, like these are the days and this is the time.
Is it going to be a weekly batch or it is a weekend batch?
Yeah, definitely we will include the weekend, but except weekend we are planning like what are the days we can include.
It would be great if we can share the course schedule and fees so that we can take a decision.
Yes, sure. Like I think Kumar will do a discussion and Kumar will share like what are the days and what is the fees details so that you can take a decision. Kumar will share with you. Yeah.
So the fees will be 8,900. Okay, it's a total 20 hours of training, guys. So as we have, Ananta has mentioned, it will not be on dummy applications, wherein we'll be injecting, some known bottlenecks. It will not be like that. This is on the live applications that we will be showing you. Okay, so the live bottlenecks. So this is how the training will be. And one more thing, what I would request all the students to be a little flexible with the timings. Okay, the timings will be same, but in a week it will be 2 to 3 classes or maybe more, because Ananta is working and he is involved in some 2 to 3 projects and really busy. So you have to be flexible as well, and he is also pulling out some time for us as well. So that's how it is. Whenever the class is there, it will be 1 hour to 1.5 hour typically, okay, with the questions. So close to 20 hours or maybe even more. This is how we are planning, 8,900. So anybody interested, you can personally contact me. So I'll be passing on my phone number is there on my address, the email that I have sent you. So you can just WhatsApp me or call me and you can go ahead with your registrations. Chandan, please go ahead.
I just have one, I can request a suggestion. It could be early in the morning or it could be late in the evening. That would be better.
That's how it will be. So because we are catering for both US students and Indian students, So whenever it will be either 6:30 a.m. or 7, or it will be around this time, which is 8 o'clock.
Okay.
That's how it will. Okay. So more.
Hello. Hi, Kumar. Kumar, this is Anil. Kumar, actually, I stay in Netherlands. So, I mean, whatever the timings that you are going to schedule, right? Maybe it would be better. I mean, even if you consider the student from Europe as well.
I know Anil. So, I have students from Malaysia. In the class, I know Mohammed is from Malaysia. You're okay. From Netherlands. And there is another Anil in the United States. So kind of hard to figure out. I mean, once the final things are done, I'm a little flexible. Along with, we have to look into Ananta's timings as well. So considering all that, I would like to come out with a time, but can't guarantee, you know, it will be feasible for all of it. But this is how it will be, Anil. It will be either mornings in India or evenings, because the most of the faculty that Isha has is the working faculty, okay, who is working, and this is the time that they can pull out either in the mornings or in the evenings.
Sure.
Okay. I'm so sorry. But I do understand the concern.
Yeah. Sir. Thanks, Kumar.
So what you can do is every session it gets recorded, even this session is getting recorded. So okay. I'll pass on the recorded sessions regularly to you if you have enrolled and you have access to Ananta on WhatsApp to ask any questions if you have, you know, on the daily basis.
Okay, sure. Thanks, Kumar.
Yeah, sure. So any more questions, guys? So few students are pinging me. They wanted to talk to me personally. So please do so. Please call me on the WhatsApp or on my phone. So I'll just let me make myself as a presenter, and I quickly leave my my phone number here. So here is the phone number, guys. My phone number. It's 918019952427. Okay, so this is the phone number. I'm also putting this on the chat window, so you can get my phone number on the chat window. So please, I'll try to send it to everybody. Hang on. So I've left my phone number on the chat window. Okay, so quickly take the phone number, and if you have any questions, please call me. Okay, so I hope nobody has any questions. Can we close the sessions, guys? Anybody has a question, this is the time to speak, else we will be closing out now.
Hello, Kumar.
Yeah, Mohammed, go ahead.
Yeah. Let's say by any chance, like if you're not able to join the session of 5-member team, right? So we can join the next session, right? Or maybe after a week or 2 weeks, or second batch.
Yes, Mohammed. So we will be starting. The batches will be there continuously. Okay, but we can't guarantee when it will be, because it totally depends upon the trainer's availability. It might be immediately, or there might be a month gap. So you have to be flexible on that front as well. And one more thing is, every session gets recorded, and you will get the recorded videos. So in case if you miss out a session, or you are a little late to the session, so you can always go back and look into the recorded videos, and you can talk to the trainer personally for any questions you might have on that. So, and these videos that I record, you have a lifetime access on that, so don't worry. And as you said, you can not only this particular course, any course, if you're not able to, I mean, you have attended, you have paid the fee, but for whatever the reason you couldn't attend it, so you can always attend the next batch, the batch after that. So that flexibility we always have with Isha.
Okay. Thank you, Kumar. Thank you so much.
But just that you have to be a little flexible from your end as well to see when the next batch starts, and you have to be a little patient.
Sure.
But you should have batches running regularly.
Okay. Thank you.
So already there are two enrollments happens, guys. So people have WhatsApped me. So it's two people who have interested already. So there are only three more seats left, guys. So just wanted to inform you. Okay. So thank you so much for joining, and so we will leave it here. And Anantha, thank you so much for pulling out the time and
it's fine. Yeah, we have.
Yeah.
So thank you guys. Bye bye. Take care.
Thank you.
Thanks, Rajesh.